السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سار على نهجه ومستن بسنته إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. فاتقوا الله أيها الأحباب، فقد أمرنا سبحانه وتعالى في تنزيله: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. ثم أما بعد. My brothers and sisters, not only do I welcome you here today on this blessed day of this blessed hour of يوم الجمعة, but we welcome all of you to once again another khutbah in the most blessed time and the most blessed month of the entire year, في شهر رمضان. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, accept from us our siyam, and accept from us our qiyam, and accept from us our efforts, خاصة في هذا الشهر, especially in this month of Ramadan. أيها الأحباب, you all know that in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah Azza wa Jal tells us everything that we need to know about Ramadan. From ayah number 183 to ayah number 186. If you want to know everything that there is to know about the month of Ramadan, you just go to Surah Al-Baqarah, to these ayat. And we've all heard them. Allah Azza wa Jal begins by saying, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, O you who believe, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ, we have written down and prescribed for you the siyam. كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْرِكُمْ, the same way that we prescribed it for the people that came before you. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, in order that you establish taqwa. Everyone, we've heard this ayah. All of us, we know this ayah and we know it well. But there's a couple of things that I want to bring your attention to. أولاً أيها الأحباب, number one, Allah Azza wa Jal says that He has given us fasting. طيب, we understand this and alhamdulillah we accept it. But it sounds as though Allah Azza wa Jal gives us a reason why He's given us fast. And He says to us, the same way that I have given it to the people that came before you. It's as if Allah gives us a reason why He's prescribing fasting to us. But Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't need to do this. If Allah says kun, fayakun. If Allah Azza wa Jal says be, then it is and we accept it. Sami'na wa ata'na. But the interesting thing, brothers and sisters, about this ayah is that Allah Azza wa Jal is giving us a historical fact. He's telling us that the one thing that ties you today in this generation from all the generation and all the umam that came before you is the siyam. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once told us that all of the sacred books have been revealed in the month of Ramadan. The Torah, the Injil, the Zabur, and the Quran, وصحف إبراهيم وموسى, and also the scriptures of إبراهيم وموسى. All of this has been revealed in the month of Ramadan. It is Siyam that ties us from the people who came before us. How? لعلكم تتقون. Now if you listen to the ayah how it ends, Allah Azza wa Jal says, I've given you fast so that you can establish taqwa. طيب, how? Allah doesn't tell you how to do it. Allah only says to you, fast so you attain taqwa. How do you know you've attained it? How do you know you have that taqwa? There is a great wisdom, brothers and sisters, as to why Allah Azza wa Jal leaves this open. It's because it's up to you and I to figure out how to find taqwa within ourselves. You cannot go to somebody and say, give me taqwa. Or you cannot go to someone else and say, teach me taqwa. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ Allah Azza wa Jal tells us in Surah Al-Ra'd how to figure out when you can find taqwa. Nobody will ever be able to change or to cause change until they start that process of change within themselves. It's until you realize where your own mistakes are, only then you can sift it out, only then you can establish taqwa. So Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't tell us how to do it because He wants it to be open. Use your imagination. Think about your life. Think about your marriage. Think about your children. At this very moment, think about what your children are doing in this khutbah. And what do I mean by this? Think about if your children are actually listening to the khutbah or they're on their cell phone. Or if they're talking to somebody else. Or if they're laughing or giggling. Think about where the priorities of your children are. And the best way to know this is just go back to the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. When he was a young boy, between 13 and 16 years old, he already understood La ilaha illallah. And he went out and he preached it to everyone. And even to his father, who was not only a person of shirk, a mushrik, but he was the person in charge of making idols and selling it to other people. And still he goes to his father and he says, Ya Abati, O my beloved father, I call you to the oneness of Allah. And then the father responds to him and says, O my son, get out from here. If you don't stop preaching La ilaha illallah to me, I will have the town come and extinguish you, get rid of you, kill you, and leave you out of this ummah, out of this nation, out of this village. Listen to the response of Ibrahim alayhi salam at such a young age. He tells his father, Ya Abati, O my father, I will still continue to ask Allah Azza wa Jal for forgiveness and salam and peace for you. And he leaves. He doesn't fight, he doesn't argue, he doesn't say, why do you speak to me that way? But he simply responds with kindness and respect. That is what siyam should do. Brothers and sisters, if at this point, approximately a week now of siyam has done, if at this point you haven't been able to figure out where the weak points in your life is as opposed to the strength, then there is a problem. It's taking too long. The process is taking too long. You don't want to lose a single day of fasting in the month of Ramadan, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us, every single day when you fast, you place a distance of 70 years between you and the hellfire. Every single day that you fast. So imagine that every single day you're fasting and you still can't improve yourself. You still can't establish the one thing that Allah Azza wa Jal expects from you, and that is to have taqwa. Have fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. Be conscious that Allah Azza wa Jal is always watching you. Be conscious that Allah Azza wa Jal sees you when you walk outside, sees you when you come in, sees you in your car, sees you when you're in your marriage, in your homes, on the plane, in the train, on the sidewalk, everywhere. Ittaqillah haythuma kunt. As the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in an authentic hadith narrated in a Tirmidhi, fear Allah Azza wa Jal wherever you are. Now look at the next ayah after this ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, the one immediately after, ayah number 184. Allah Azza wa Jal, after telling us the ruling and the history of the siyam, and He gives us the reason why He's given us siyam. The first thing that He mentions immediately after that, He says, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. It's only a few days. This word ma'dudat, it means that it's something so trivial. It's like counting something from your fingers. Ayyaman ma'dudat, just a few days. And really and truly, out of all the days in the year, you take 1 month And it's not even an entire day, it's just the daily hours of your day. You abstain from the things that are most beloved to you, the food, drink, and desires. And so Allah Azza wa Jal, the first thing He wants us to know, before He continues this ayah. Now realize, brothers and sisters, ayah number 184, Allah Azza wa Jal is going to give us some of the legal aspects or the legal breakdown of Ramadan. So now Allah Azza wa Jal wants to give us the fiqh of Ramadan. And this is the sunnah whenever you teach a subject. You start off by defining that subject. You start off by giving the importance of that subject. You start off by giving the reasons why you study that subject. And then you get into the crux. Then you get into the juice of that subject. And that is what we will see now. Allah Azza wa Jal says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ Allah Azza wa Jal, it's really interesting why He mentions this. Immediately after He tells us that fasting is just a few days, it's like it gives you this mental influence that inshallah it's going to be easy. Inshallah it's not going to be difficult. But Allah Azza wa Jal also knows that even with that frame of mind, there is still going to be hardship. There's still going to be people that just can't fast. There's still going to be times in our lives where we just can't do it. How do you know? Allah gives us some of the main reasons why people cannot fast. The first one He says is because of sickness. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا Whoever amongst you is sick. Now here, brothers and sisters, it is very simple. The scholars, they break this down into two categories. You are either temporarily sick or you are either permanently sick. So if you are temporarily sick, you are to try to fast until it becomes difficult for you. So if you have a headache or you cough or you sneeze, this is not an excuse not to fast because it's something that is temporary. But as for the person that is permanently sick, the person who has diabetes or cancer or something like that, then here you do not fast. But what do? Do you just go on each and every single day as normal? We will come to this in a moment. Allah Azza wa Jal gives us the second reason why people cannot fast, and that is hardship. So the first one is sickness. Then the second one is fi safar, whilst they are traveling. In other words, Allah Azza wa Jal is saying during the times of hardship and difficulty, Allah Azza wa Jal has given you a rukhsa, given you an opportunity to make the choice if you can fast or not. And we will see this ayah one more time bi-idhnillah. And then Allah Azza wa Jal tells us about the people who are not sick, they are not traveling, but they just simply because of their state, they cannot fast. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ فَطَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ وَمَنْ تَطَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ وَأَنْ تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, if you're the person who has reached an age and a time in your life that you simply cannot do it, then pay a penalty, pay the fidya. And if you yourself cannot do it, assign somebody else that can do it for you. Who is this person? This is the elderly. This is the person that is weak. This is the person that has reached a time in his life that even if they tried to fast, they could not complete it. Brothers and sisters, you can also understand the ayah from its opposite. For a young child that cannot fast, the opposite of this ayah is to encourage your children to try to fast. Even if it is with just a moment of the day. Don't think that just because your children are not mature enough, they cannot try to fast. We understand that they cannot complete the fast. We understand that they are not mukallaf. It is not obliged upon them to fast. But the least, brothers and sisters, as mothers and fathers, the least that you want to do is wake up your child for suhoor. And let them taste what suhoor feels like. Or wake up your child for Salatul Fajr. And let them taste what it feels like to pray and worship at that time of the morning. or get them to fast 1 hour of the day, 2 hours of the day. Let them have their breakfast, let them fast the lunchtime. Try to be creative with your children to introduce to them one of the greatest acts of worship by Allah Azza wa Jal. And this will solve a lot of problems for you. I get it all the time that people will email me, mothers and fathers will send me messages asking me, Brother Musleh, how can I get my 15-year-old son, my 20-year-old child, my 30-year-old child to fast? How can I do it? The problem happened from the very beginning. The source of the problem is how it began in the first place, where we didn't help or teach our children and introduce them to acts of worship. Because the problem is that many parents think they need to overindulge their children from the very get-go. So when their children is ready to pray, they need to be at the masjid 24 hours or every single salah. This is not the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he tells us to try to do things as moderate as you can, as easy as you can. Step by step, bi-idhnillah, you will find that insha'Allah you will have children like Ibrahim alayhi salam. So Allah Azza wa Jal gives us the ruling of Siyam, then gives us an introduction to the fiqh or the legal aspect of Siyam. Then ayah number 185, it continues and it says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. Allah Azza wa Jal now talks about the most important aspect of the month of Ramadan. The month of Ramadan. Allah Azza wa Jal calls Ramadan by its name. There is no month in the Arabic calendar that is referred to by its name except the month of Ramadan. That alone shows you and I how beloved this month is to Allah Azza wa Jal. And He tells us, this is the month that I've sent the Quran to you. And I've sent it, and He gives us a reason why. Allah Azza wa Jal never has to give us a reason why to do things. But still out of His rahmah, out of His mercy, He tells us the reasons why. And He says, I've sent it to you so that it could be a source of guidance. And it could be a criterion that you will know what is halal and what is haram. And then Allah Azza wa Jal says it again, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Then Allah Azza wa Jal continues and He says the exact same thing. If you're sick, if you're traveling, if you have hardship upon you, then make up your fast at a later time. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues in the same ayah, not in this order, but Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرِ فَلْيَصُمْ وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Allah Azza wa Jal tells us a number of things now in ayah number 185. And He tells us about the Quran. He tells us the reason, the main reason why you have Quran. And then He tells us that whomever amongst you has witnessed and seen the moon, فَلْيَصُمْ, let him go and fast. And this of course brings us to a huge problem. That every single month, in the every single Ramadan, the beginning of the month, what do you have? You have problems with the moon sighting. So it doesn't become moon sighting anymore. It ends up becoming moon fighting. And then you have the same problem at the end of Ramadan. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make it easy for us. Because clearly in the ayah, Allah Azza wa Jal says, if you see the moon, then fast. That's it. And then Allah Azza wa Jal talks about the same issues and tells us that all I want for you, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ, all I want for you is only ease. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Verily after every pain, difficulty, there will always be ease, multiple avenues of ease. And then Allah Azza wa Jal concludes this ayah. and tells us yuridu Allahu bikumul yusra wa la yuridu bikumul usra wa litukmilul idda wa litukabbirullaha ala ma hadakum wa la'allakum tashkurun. This summarizes the whole purpose of fast. Give thanks, be grateful. Be grateful of what Allah Azza wa Jal has given you. This is why one of the greatest mistakes that people make, especially when it comes to the iftar, is they begin to cook so much food and hoard down as much food as they can. And they lose the entire spirit of Ramadan. If you feel hungry, you're supposed to. If you feel that the Ramadan is difficult for you, it's supposed to be. If you feel as though you're always starving and you're always hungry and you need thirst or you need to rest and relax and so on, it's okay. Because nobody had this and exemplified this more than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Brothers and sisters, these are the words that I leave you with in the first part of the khutbah. And inshallah ta'ala, in the second part, we will conclude with ayah number 186, how Allah Azza wa Jal concludes his discussion about Ramadan. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to shower his rahmah upon us, especially in this month, but throughout our lives. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to accept from us our siyam, our qiyam, our ruku', our sujood, ya rabbal alameen. Aqulu ma tasma'oon wa astaghfirullaha li wa lakum wa risa'ilil muslimin min kulli dham fastaghfiru innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد, after Allah Azza wa Jal tells us about Ramadan, gives us the rulings of Ramadan, tells us that the entire month is based upon ease and no hardship in it, Allah Azza wa Jal concludes and says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. Listen to the wording of the ayah. Allah says, if my slave asks about me. Brothers and sisters, this ayah here, 186, it was revealed in a response to a question that the Sahabas had. The Sahabas, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, the response of Allah, should we try to look for that response or will the response come to us automatically? And Allah Azza wa Jal sent down this ayah to answer that question. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. The first thing Allah Azza wa Jal says, He doesn't say, if my slave asks about me, tell him I will answer. Allah first says, tell him that I am close to him. What does this mean? It means that even if you don't ask Allah, He is still there for you. It means that if you don't raise your hand in dua, Allah's mercy, His rahmah, His protection is still going to be hovering over you. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. I will answer the dua of the person who calls upon me only if they ask. From this ayah, you understand that if you do not ask Allah, Allah will not answer you. If you want your dua to be answered, you need to ask Allah Azza wa Jal to answer that dua. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Go and tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that by no means I will answer that dua. So not only am I close to you, but at the same time I will answer your prayers. I will answer those tears. I will answer the cry. When a woman, she sits down by herself and she makes dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, especially in this month, and she says, ya Rabb, my marriage is going downhill. Ya Rabb, nothing is going great for me. I cannot conceive a child. What does Allah Azza wa Jal say? قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. Allah Azza wa Jal says, verily He hears the cry of the woman when she raises her hands and she complains to Allah Azza wa Jal, Ya Rabb, listen to me. There is no way out for me. Then the ayah concludes, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. ما قال الله عز وجل لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ أو لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ أو لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. Allah عز وجل does not say in the end of this ayah, in order that they may give thanks to me, or they may ponder, or they may remember me, but rather Allah عز وجل says, يَرْشُدُونَ. And this is the words that I will leave you with. The word yarshudun, brothers and sisters, it comes from the word rushdun. Rushdun, it means a guardianship. So Allah Azza wa Jal says, in order that you will receive my guardianship and my protection, you need to continue to make dua for me. And just think about it logically, how much sense this makes. If you have a friend that you don't know very well, you see him on and off, that friend comes to you and says, look, I need your help. How much are you inclined to help a person that you're just acquainted to? As opposed to somebody you see every day, you talk to them all the time, they come and they ask for your help, how inclined are you to help that person? And so, brothers and sisters, the more you pray to Allah and make dua to Him, the more chance, the more likely Allah Azza wa Jal will answer your dua. Why? Because you've been close to Him in the very beginning anyways. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our dua. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our qiyam and our siyam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our efforts that we put forth in this dunya so that we can reap the benefits in Jannah fil akhirah, ya Rabbil Alameen. Brothers and sisters, we conclude and we send peace to and blessings to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Kama amarana subhanahu wa ta'ala fi tanzili, inna allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-nabi, ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma aghfir al-muslimina wal-muslimat, wal-mu'minina wal-mu'minat, الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك قريب سميع مجيب الدعوات اللهم إننا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.